Welcome to Reach City Church. We are so glad that you decided to join us this morning. We just want to tell you about a few things that we have coming up. The men and women have started back into their Bible studies. The men are going through the book Disciplines for a Godly Man on Tuesday evening, starting at 7 p.m. And the women are going through the book Lies Women Believe and the Truth That Sets Them Free on Wednesday at 7 p.m. If you download our app, you can go into our events page and you'll see exactly what's going on and how to connect with the men or the women. Or you can email us at office@reachchurchcle.com. We're also excited to let you know that we have a lot of great things coming up starting in February. Have you been discouraged? Do you need encouragement? Are you always looking for a place to where you can get some prayer midweek? We got you. We're going to start a weekly prayer line going live on our YouTube channel, and it'll also be there for you to refer back to anytime you just need to be encouraged or uplifted. You'll have an opportunity to be able to ask for prayer right in the live chat. So we're excited to see how that's going to be able to help encourage you throughout your week. We also are going to start back up with Story Time with Miss Myrna. I'll be going live on Fridays at 1 p.m. on our YouTube channel. You'll be able to join me live, or you'll be able to go back and allow your children to just see the wonderful books that I'll be reading. There'll be a time of conversation for you and your little ones, and I'll start you off with some great questions that you'll be able to ask. We're going to be going into our prayer and fasting ministry in February. Our goal is that every day someone will be going before the throne of God and fasting and prayer. We already do a corporate prayer and fasting twice a month, but we like to have every day covered. If you'd like to know more about how you too can join us in that prayer and fasting, we'd love to have you. You can go on again, the app, and you can next steps contact us, and we will be glad to add you to our prayer and fasting team. For those that are members of Reach City Church, if you haven't yet reached out to me about joining the team, there's still time. Just send me a message via text or at my email address. We just thank you so much again for joining us. If you've been encouraged by the services that you've been watching, and you are encouraged by the things that you just see happening here at Reach City Church, and you're like, Myrna, how can I know more about what's going on? Well, I'm glad you asked. Download our app or go on our social media pages. If you go to the app, it'll say Next Steps. You can fill out a form there and someone will get back to you about either ways that you can join our ministry or ways that you can give to our ministry. The things that we're doing here at Reach City Church are only God ordained, and we're so thankful for the things that He has allowed us to be able to do in our time here. We are not a big ministry, but we have a big God, and we just trust and believe in Him for everything it is that He has asked us to do. But we need your help in order to continue to make a difference in the community that He has placed us in. You can become a partner where you give on a monthly basis, or you can become a one-time donor. Go to our app and you'll see the section says give. You can choose whether you want to be a weekly or a monthly giver. You can set up automatic giving, or you can give us a one-time gift. There is no amount too small and definitely not too large that God won't be able to use for the advancement of His kingdom. We thank you for believing in us enough, knowing that we are following the lead of our Lord and Savior, and that we will be a good steward with everything that you bless us with. We thank you. We pray that you have just a wonderful week. And thank you again for tuning in to Reach City Church.
And I pray that as you sit at home, that His presence comes and rests upon you. That you welcome His presence today. For God, you are our strength. The joy of the Lord is our strength.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
The joy of the Lord is our strength. Like, I have been through some
Be rich. we rise to greet you, because you are the King of our hearts, the King of our lives. Lord God, won't you be the King of our household? Won't you be the kings of our families? Won't you be our King in our jobs, Lord God? We thank you and we praise you, oh God, for ruling in our lives, ruling in our thoughts, ruling, Lord God. We yield to you. We can't do anything without you.
You're never gonna let me down. Exodus 14 and 14 says, the Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. The Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. Today's message is going to be an introduction to this new series that I'm going to be calling Be Still. And this introductory message is called Be Still, Be Silent, and Wait. Be Still, Be Silent, and Wait. And listen, the reality is 2020 was a mess. Right, and so I love this meme. It's this meme that I seen on Facebook, and this meme was a picture of this person showing this other person around, and the caption underneath it said, 2020 showing 2021 around the workplace. And so when I saw that, I chuckled. And then shortly after my chuckle, we hit the highest death rate in the day from COVID-19, and then we had the Capitol insurrection happen, and suddenly, the meme wasn't so funny. Suddenly, the meme took on a reality that just because the calendar date changed doesn't mean everything will cease and go back to how we want it to be. Just because things change in the calendar doesn't mean that things will go back to the way that we desired them to be. And if this year already hasn't shown us that we are still very much in 2020's mess, even in 2021, then these first few weeks should be very clear about that, right? And so many of us are still in this place where we don't know what 2021 is going to bring. We don't know if 2021 is going to restore everything that everybody said we were going to get back, right? Many of us don't even know if 2021 is anything like 2020, if we'll be able to actually sustain, if we'll be actually able to press through, right? Many of us don't know how we'll deal with the burdens of the unknown. And maybe like myself, it's not just 2020 stuff. Maybe like myself, it wasn't the COVID-19 stuff. Maybe for you, it's still just the 2019 and the 2018 and the 27 cares of life that are weighing heavy on you, that are burdens to you. Maybe it's just life and the chaos of it, period, that has you burdened and trying to figure out life in 2021. And so I decided for that reason that I'm going to come out of Amos and I'm going to start this new series that would speak to the climate of the people's life. Because many of us are trying to figure out how to hold on and not lose control or go into this dark mental space. Many of us are trying to figure out how to muster up enough the strength to press through another year when we don't quite yet see how this year is going to be any different than last year. Now, I want you to notice that I said us, right? Because 2020 was tough for me also. And if I'm honest, I feel anxious. I felt anxious, rather. I felt fearful. I felt defeated. And I had a range of other emotions. My wife and I, we're cool, so I don't want anybody here to be like, they cool? Like, my wife and I, we cool. However, like my wife said 2 weeks ago, things just ain't been making sense lately. And I think many of us also feel that way. And so what do you do in those moments? What do you do in those moments when you're feeling like you're failing as a father because your teenager isn't chasing after Jesus? What do you do in those moments when you sometimes feel like a fraud because you can disciple the whole world, but you can't figure out how to get your teenager to chase after Jesus? Questioning if it's COVID-19 or if it's just a reflection of my leadership that has us kind of in this stuck place in ministry. And I see it all around the world, people coming and being blessed and starting new things. And I rejoice with them, and I pray for their continued success daily, but I still have the question sometimes to God, when is it our time? Right? We sacrifice it all. We give it all. We love hard, right? And if you reap what you sow, well, where's our harvest, Jesus? What do you do in those moments? Well, you're supposed to pray. Right? At least that's what I was taught. At least that's what I teach you. And Kareem 4 weeks ago told us, listen, in those moments when we are burdened with anxiety, that we should be praying. And so I don't say that facetiously. However, I say it to confirm that if you actually are feeling overwhelmed, feeling down, feel defeated, yes, in those moments, yes, you are supposed to pray. But what do you do when you do what you're supposed to do and you still don't have a clue? You still don't feel comforted. You still don't feel peace. Because that's how I felt one morning, praying on my couch, overthinking everything like I normally do. And I asked God about everything that I just mentioned. And his answer to me was two words on the screen when I opened my eyes. Be still. So the next day, I prayed the exact same prayer because that answer just ain't do it for me. And so I thought maybe God mixed up my answer with somebody else that was praying at the exact same time, because I know I didn't just cry my heart out to him and he said to me, while I'm trying to figure out how to not be anxious, while I'm trying to figure out the next move, I know he must have mixed my prayer answer up when he told me to be still. That had to be for my next door neighbor, right? So the next day, I had the exact same conversation with him because I didn't like the answer he gave me the day before. And so his answer to me, again, when I opened my eyes, was one word, wait. And if you're asking me, like, what's these words from, when I pray to piano music in the background. And because I pray to piano music in the background, the tracks sometimes change. And so these words on the screen, when I open my eyes, is whatever that next track is in the piano meditation thing. So it's not like I picked a meditation that said, be still or wait. So I assume that God must actually be trying to tell me something. However, let's just be honest. I didn't like the answer. Right? And I know I'm talking to somebody. I know I'm talking to somebody who feels the exact same way, who in their own prayer time received a response from God that had them more stressful, more frustrated than peaceful. Maybe you don't even pray no more, because the answers you receive from God when you pray leave you more, have you feeling more abandoned than peace. Instead of being comforted, you feel cold. In the midst of anxiety, fear, frustration, self-worthlessness, or whatever you're crying out to God for help, his answer left you wanting. Be still and wait. that's all you got for me, right? Being told in the chaos of my life and needing answers to be still and wait are not the encouraging words that I expected from my good father, because that's what they tell me he is, right? Being still and wait is not the answers that I thought from a God who says he's a very present help in our time in need. Being still and wait was an answer that I expect from somebody who don't know the answers. Be still and wait is the answer I give people when they bring something to me, and I'm like, you just got to be still and wait. I don't know, but God supposed to know. So the fact that God gave me that answer, I wasn't feeling it. How does being still actually fix a problem, right? COVID attacked my business, and every dime I have is wrapped up in my business. And if I fail, I'll lose everything. God, in your word, says that you're a very present help in our time of need. So God, help. And his answer is, be still. Or maybe you're struggling with depression and grief, and God, your word says you turn mourning into dancing, sorrows into joy. And so God, turn it around for me. And yet his answer is, be still. Maybe your money funny, your relationship strange, and you just need God to fix it. And yet when you call on him, his answer is still, be still. I don't want to fornicate no more, but I love him. We got kids together. I want to keep our family together, but he won't marry me. She won't marry me. God changed their heart. And again, be still. I know many of y'all understand what I'm saying. Y'all have heard a response from God when looking to be comforted by God that left you walking away feeling more frustrated and feeling more abandoned by God, because the answer you received did and does not appear to be the answer that actually helps. So what do you do in those moments when you pray and God's answer leaves you more discouraged than encouraged? So I started thinking about this because I felt like that. And so I'm sitting there and I'm like, this onslaught of, man, God don't care about me. This onslaught of, man, God ain't worried about me. This onslaught of, man, God ain't got my back. All of these thoughts start hitting me because the month was crazy. The month was stressful. And because of the way I'm wired, I don't even like asking for help. So even when I'm going through hard times in life, even with God, it's hard for me to pour out my heart to him. So then when I pour it out, you be still? Yeah. So all I can think is, see, this is why I ain't praying. That's why I'm praying, God. Are you praying, telling me to do the same thing that I thought I was doing already? I thought I was already being, listen, you know how frustrated it is when you go to somebody and you're talking to them? And they give you a whole bunch of solutions that, like, you ain't did it already. Right. Like, you stupid. Like, hey, my laptop don't work. And Kareem be like, turn it off, turn it back on. I try. Or better yet, you know when you call the people when your Wi-Fi not working, right, at home, and you call them, and they be like, okay, we got to go through this series of tests. Would you turn off your, you don't think I already unplugged it and did the hard reset? I don't have time for you to tell me things that I feel like I've already done. God, I already been still. Yeah. I need you to tell me what to do. Not that it's time to make a move. Right. That tell me to be still. I've been paralyzed already.
Come on. Wow.
So, when all those thoughts pour in your head, let me just give you a couple thoughts. First thing you want to do is you want to recognize the opportunity of the enemy and realize that he's taking it. Yeah. Recognize the opportunity of the enemy and realize that he's taking it. Here's what I mean. The devil preys with an E on our vulnerability to the ambiguity. That gooey word comes out like that, right? But the devil preys on the vulnerability of the ambiguity of God's response to plant seeds of doubt and distrust towards God, right? And here's what I mean. I put it in I like battle rapping, so it's this rapper called Sue Surf, and he always say something that goes over people's head, and then he says, well, I got to put it in subtitles or something, so let me put it in subtitles. God's response to us can be interpreted in more than one way. Therefore, knowing that pain and chaos clouds judgment, this is proven scientifically, the devil plays on our emotions so that we understand God's response not for our good and encouragement, rather as abandonment and evil. So what the devil does is, because we're vulnerable, because we're in need, because we're dealing with the chaoses of our life, what the devil does when God gives an answer that seems to not be the answer that we need, the devil creeps in and he starts to play on our understanding of God, and he starts to plant these seeds of distrust. He starts to plant these seeds of abandonment. He starts to plant these seeds of evil. And because we're already going through trauma, we listen to him, and we actually start to believe it. But he's simply just preying on the fact that we're vulnerable. He uses our vulnerability and chaos to twist our understanding of what God says and what God does so that what we receive from God in prayer appears to be discomforting. And listen, this has been his agenda from the beginning. He hasn't done anything different from the beginning. He's been twisting our understanding of God, what he says and what he does, from the beginning. Genesis 3:1, right? Now the serpent was more craftier than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, did God actually say, you should not eat of the tree in the garden? Notice he's attacking the understanding of what God said. So in those moments when God is actually speaking, but we're not understanding what he's saying, Satan comes in and he attacks that. And so sometimes we may be cool with the answer, like, trust in me. But then Satan creeps in and he'd be like, well, what does that actually really mean? Aren't you already trusting in him? So if you're already trusting in him and he's telling you to trust in him, maybe God just playing with you. And so you start thinking about it. Right? Because Satan plants a seed of doubt on what we understand about God. But then he also goes into verse 4 and 5 and he says, but the serpent said to the woman, you will not surely die. For God knows that what you eat of, when you eat of it, your eyes will be open and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Now you notice he attacks what God is doing. Right? He makes it less about God's protection and more about God's selflessness. So when God says something or does something that we don't understand, Satan comes in and he makes us think that it's God being evil, it's God not caring about us. He completely clouds our ability to understand that sometimes God's no is for our protection. But instead, he makes us think that God's no is about him not caring about us. Satan is constantly trying to trick us. He is constantly trying to twist up the words of what God is saying. And in those moments of vulnerability, of pain, and suffering, and chaos of life, when you desperately need to hear from God, he creeps in the silence of God and causes us to doubt God. And some of us have walked away from God because of those answers. He comes in, and God says, "Be still and wait," and Satan immediately whispers, "But I thought he was a good father." See, he knows we got abandonment issues, and so he whispers, "I thought he would never leave you or forsake you. He's no better than your earthly father." He knows we struggle with self-blame, so he whispers, "I thought God was a gracious God, but because of you lied," or, you know how when God don't answer, sometimes we start thinking about all the things we did that may not have been right. And so now we start to doubt. Now we start to feel like it's my fault that God not talking to me. I did something wrong, right? And so he knows we have these different issues. He knows we have distrust issues. And so he creeps in and he says, "See, you can't even count on God. You really can't trust nobody." And so what do you do with that? And the reality is, you have to never forget that from the beginning of time, from the beginning of people's interaction with somebody outside of God, God let us know Satan is more craftier than anybody. We have to remember in those moments of God's answer that we don't like, when all of these things start to flood in, all of these negative thoughts about God starts to flood in, immediately we have to remember and recognize the lies of the enemy. We have to remember John 10:10, the thief comes to steal and kill and destroy, but I came that you may have life and have it abundantly. God is not trying to destroy you, the enemy is. Therefore, you have to rebuke those thoughts and seek out the understanding of what God has said, because he never responds in a way that's not for our benefit. But then I started thinking again. I said, but why do we even let those thoughts sit with us? And the reality is, like, I get them too. But what's the difference of me getting up and eventually rebuking those thoughts, and why some people sit with those thoughts and let them manifest in their life, internalize them, create faith conflicts, and then walk away? Well, I thought about this. How well we know God determines how we interpret what he's saying and doing. There's two passages in scripture. Nah, the Holy Spirit ain't just giving me the location right now, so you're going to have to search it for yourself. But there's two passages in Scripture. One, both of them talk about the rushing waves, right? And in Revelation, it talks about it, but when it talks about it, it talks about it in the way of peace. And then in Jeremiah or Ezekiel, when he talks about it in the way that brings fear, right? The same rushing waves, but two different understandings. John heard it as peace, but the enemies of God saw it as fear and terror. Because how our relationship with God determines how we understand the things that God is doing. If I'm in close relationship with God, I begin to understand what he's doing differently than a person who's not in close relationship with God. How well we know God determines how we interpret what he's saying and what he's doing. How you know God will keep you even when his answers and actions confuse you. How you know God will keep you even when his answers and what he's doing confuses you.
Teach the word, PT.
Listen, people who don't know you will always misunderstand, misinterpret, and think the worst of you in moments of conflict. And when God doesn't respond the way we think he should or want, it creates this internal and faith conflict. And people who do not know you in conflict will always hear you wrong and think the worst of you. That's just reality. I deal with it all the time. I always tell the story of my wife calling me a Pharisee back when we was just peers in ministry, right? And you can argue, maybe I was a little Pharisee, right? Maybe, who knows? However, when we started dating, my wife stopped calling me a Pharisee because she started to understand my heart. She started to understand the thing that drives me. She started to understand that my motivation or my pressure or my being on their back, whatever you want to call it, was less about trying to think I'm perfect and trying to make perfect people, and more about being motivated by wanting to see the best out of a person's walk, by wanting to see people grow, by wanting to see people mature. And so she found herself, when we got into relationship with each other, defending those accusations against me instead of holding them. Now, somebody can be like, "Well, that's it. She defended you because she's your wife." Well, you're missing the point. The fact that she's my wife means she's in close relationship with me, right? My wife isn't defending me. Trust me, my wife will check me when I'm wrong. She's not defending me because she's just my wife. She's defending me because when we entered into relationship with each other, she started to learn me. She started to know me. She started to realize who I am as a person, what drives me, what motivates me. And so she's defending me because of an intimate connection. Sometimes she doesn't even understand what I'm doing, even to this day. But her knowledge of who I am, what drives me, what motivates me, allows her to follow me even in the ambiguity of my moment. See, the enemy can only lie to a person who has no intimate knowledge of another person. All right? And it blows me, right? This is why it blows us. We talk about it all the time, right? When somebody that you're supposed to know misinterprets you. And it hurts. It makes us dang near want to cut them off saying, listen, clearly we ain't as close as I thought we were. You clearly ain't the friend I thought you was, so maybe we don't even need to be friends, you know, right? Cancel culture, right? Now, let's just be honest. We walked into that. Because I wonder if God be thinking like that. I wonder when we allow the devil to twist God's words and actions towards us and we believe it. I wonder if he says, you clearly don't know me like I thought you knew me. We clearly don't have a relationship that I thought we had. Like, listen, you can sit with that or you can even sit with this. Because sometimes we go as far to even cut a person off if they didn't check the person that was speaking negatively about us. Listen, to this day, I got people that I do not deal with no more like that because they was able to tell me all the negative things somebody said about me. Now, listen. We ain't who I thought we were. Because the fact that you got to the end of that conversation before you stopped that conversation tells me we ain't who I thought we were. Because can't nobody start a conversation talking negatively about my people and I listen to the whole thing before I check them and say, hold up, wait a minute, let me get them on the phone. Hold on, wait a minute, you should tell you that with them. You ain't not to me, you not. Right? But yet, we sit and allow the devil to tell us about our God. We listen to what he says instead of rebuking him and telling him to flee, to get away from us. We actually sit and allow the devil to tell us something about the person we say is our God, the person we say is our Father, the person we praise on Sunday, the person we worship to in the shower. But when the devil started talking, we start listening instead of rebuking him and telling him, get away from me, shut up. We listen, internalize it, and then we even believe it. Can I tell you something? The problem is not what God says. The problem is how we understand what God says. And how we understand what God says depends on how well we know God. And I know, first time back, 6 weeks, 7 weeks, I know. I ain't gonna make you shout. I probably never make you shout. But I ain't trying to entertain you. Listen, if COVID-19 and the storming of the Capitol building hasn't told us anything, it's telling us that playtime is over. It's time for us to be equipped, prepared, anchored, and ready. And listen, anytime a person can convince you about something that is a lie about another person, you really didn't know that person. And I know you may be saying, whoops, because you probably may be that person. And so you say, like, that ain't true. Okay, maybe you know the person, but there's a couple different forms of knowledge. See, you can know cognitively, or you can know empirically or experientially, right? And what we need to have is both. Many of us only know one way. See, cognitive knowledge speaks to knowing facts and information about a person. For example, Matthew 6, 7 and 8. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for the Father knows what you need before you ask him. Notice that this knowledge is about possession of knowledge and understanding. See, to have cognitive knowledge of God is to only have head knowledge. Meaning, when it comes to what you heard, maybe you study, maybe a preacher said, and that's fine. Cognitive knowledge matters. I'm definitely not knocking it. It is equally beneficial. However, it is limited and attackable. See, whenever the trials of life impact us most, the enemy attacks what we know cognitively about God. It's those questions that enter our mind from before about, did God really say? Did we understand God? Does the Bible really say? What does it mean? Again, I'm not knocking it, but I believe, and some of you understand this, that cognitive knowledge alone is limited to comfort us through storms, trials, downtimes, pandemics, and pain. John the Baptist cognitively knew who Jesus was, but when he was in prison facing death, his cognitive understanding could not speak louder than his trial. And so he said, are you the one, or should I wait for another? Well, brother, you told the whole world to follow him. But now your pain, your trials are screaming louder than your cognitive understanding, and you start to doubt because the enemy attacks your cognitive understanding. The Israelites cried out to God, save us from the Egyptians, and he did it. They saw his power. They worshiped him because of it as deliverer. But when they got hungry in the wilderness, they grumbled against God and accused him of bringing them into the wilderness to kill them. See, their cognitive understanding of the power of God couldn't speak louder than their hunger pains. Many of us have said in church, have said in Bible studies, year after year, learning about God. And yet cognitive knowledge doesn't speak louder than our pandemic or the chaos in our life. And because of that, when we go through things, we misunderstand God's silence as abandonment. We misunderstand God's discipline as hate. We misunderstand God's no as rejection. And because there are many ways to interpret a response, cognitive understanding only leads to misinterpretation when we're going through things, because theology doesn't always match our experience. God being a good God and me experiencing pain doesn't always mesh. God being a healer and people dying seems contradictory. And so what we need more than just cognitive knowledge is we need an experiential knowledge or an empirical knowledge, those things what we touch with our senses, meaning those things that we have experienced. Because to have empirical knowledge of God means you have experienced him in a real way, which in turn produces a deeper level of intimacy and cognition. For example, 1 Corinthians 2:11, for who knows a person's thought except the spirit of a person, which is in him. So also no one comprehends cognitively the thoughts of God except the spirit of God. Notice this knowledge is understood because there is closeness, the spirit of a person. This is what empirical or experiential knowledge is. It's more than just having information. It is knowing the information based on the experiences in real life. Experiential knowledge is often understood as blind faith. This is why people accuse us of having blind faith. How can you follow a God that you can't see? How can you believe in a God that you can't see? How can you touch a God that you can't see? First off, it's a lie. But let's just imagine it's true for a second. Just because you can't touch him doesn't mean he hasn't touched you. And when people don't have experience with God, they're still trying to figure out how to touch God because they have never experienced his actual touch in their own life. Listen, I got plenty of ways cognitively to prove the existence of God. I know all of the philosophical arguments, but however, I believed God before I had the philosophical evidence. The reason was because I was a 24-year-old knucklehead sitting in jail praying to a God that I did not know, saying, if you get me out of this situation, I'll serve you the rest of my life. Video evidence, guilty of every single thing that they charged me of. But yet when I went to court after that prayer, 2 weeks later, the video that they had got damaged and they had to let me go on all charges. So I believe God, not because I read about him in a book, but because he touched me. And when you've been touched by God, the world will call it blind faith because they don't understand how being touched by God allows you to trust in God, follow God, even when everything around you seems to be falling apart. See, you may be able to attack my intellect, but you can never attack my experience with God. And that's what every trial and tribulation does. It attacks our cognitive understanding of God. But when you have both cognitive and experience, you become unmoved by storms and your experience reads between the lines of ambiguity. See, experiential knowledge sustains what cognitive knowledge muddies. See, it's those lived experiences that sustain us, that keep us from walking away when things don't make sense cognitively. Now, hear me clearly, though. I am not advocating for one or the other, right? Experience is not always truth either. And a lot of people are walking with just their experience, and experience is not always true either. You need both of them. Sometimes you need to know he loves you even when you don't feel like he loves you. 1 John 5:14, and this is the confidence that we have towards him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. It's the confidence I have, regardless if I feel like he hears me, I have the confidence to know that he does. Sometimes we need to know even when we don't feel. I'm married. My married couples, those in relationships, understand this. I know my wife loves me. Sometimes I may not feel like she loves me, or she knows I love her. Sometimes my actions may have her feel like I don't love her. And so sometimes you need to be able to anchor on the fact that I know a person loves me if their actions sometimes seem a little unloving. Now, that don't mean stay in a toxic and abusive relationship either. So I want to clear that up. But what I'm saying is that cognitive knowledge is great, and I push it all day long. But if you don't move from just learning about God to actively seeking out that deeper relationship that sustains you in a storm, that shipwreck that sustains you in shipwrecks, then you will find yourself angry at God. And the primary reason is because his ways are not our ways. His understandings are not our understandings. Therefore, I have to have a deep enough relationship with God to understand his ways, even when they don't make sense, and to trust his moves, even when they go against my own desire. See, when I have that relationship, we are able to have that Jesus in the wilderness moment. When the devil says it's written, you can say, yeah, but it's also written. When the devil says you prayed and didn't get an answer, you can say, yeah, but my God, rather when you prayed for that job and you didn't get it or get that answer, you can then say, yeah, but my God still supplies all my needs. When the devil says God don't love you, you can say, but God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, right? Like when you have that relationship with God, when the devil starts to speak to you, you start speaking back to him the truth of who God is, regardless of how you feel in the moment. But if you don't know God, you can't defend God. But God's answers ain't off our understanding is. And so because I know that God was not abandoning me when I cried out to him, I knew the problem was in how I understood this word, be still. Because when somebody tells me to be still, it means do nothing. That's just not the answer that I want to hear when I'm trying to figure out what to do. Do nothing. Well, how is that going to fix my problems? Right? If I'm crying out in anxiety, crying out in fear and frustration, and God says, be still, based on my knowing God, then I know that this answer has to actually be encouragement. This answer actually has to be something that will free me from the burdens of anxiety, the burdens from the chaos of life. And so what I decided to do was, one, tell the devil to shut up, and then not let my frustrations cripple me from receiving what God was actually instructing me to do. And so I did this study on this phrase, be still. And what I learned is that is all that we're going to learn throughout this series. I said I got to break it up because it was too much for a message, right? Because this be still phrase is very interesting. Well, I'll leave that there for now. What I learned was that indeed the answer to my prayer was that I needed to learn to be still. And this word be still is interesting. There's actually a lot of different words for it. It's two different Greek words, four different Hebrew words. And sometimes, but from the Old Testament to the New Testament, they mean the exact same thing. From the Old Testament to the New Testament, they all express this idea of being silent, silencing, or being muzzled. And so I know now you may be thinking, so wait a minute. So when God says be still, he's telling me to be quiet. So as I'm praying to God, crying out to God, you want me to believe that it's comfort in the fact that he told me to be quiet. That sounds like what you tell your kids when they being loud, wanting something, and you sleepy or you trying to watch a movie. That don't sound like you're actually trying to comfort me or answer me. And so I read that at first, and I was like, well, that's very interesting. And later on in this series, we're going to find some very interesting pieces that there's a difference in the fact that sometimes God is calling his people to be still, and other times he's calling things to be still that were affecting his people. But that's going to be next week, I think. But listen, what I began to understand was that when God is telling us to be silent, when I began to study it, what I understood was that when God says be still or be silent, God is actually telling us to chill and watch him work. When God tells us to be still or be silent, he's actually telling us, be still and chill and watch me work. And when I learned that in my studies, I was like, okay, God, you're not abandoning me. You boss it up. You're like, yo, chill, be still. You about to show out. Because whenever you read in the Bible, And whenever you read in the Bible, you see all the times when he told the Israelites to be still and watch him work, he did something crazy and amazing in their situation. Exodus 14, 10 through 14, when Pharaoh drew near, the people of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians were marching after them, and they feared greatly. And the people of Israel cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, is it because there's no graves in Egypt that you've taken us to die in the wilderness? What have we done for you to bring us out of Egypt? Is this not what we said to you in Egypt? Leave us alone that we may serve the Egyptians, for it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. And Moses said to the people, fear not, stand firm and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you only be still. the screen and say, be silent. And the verse I read at the beginning in the NIV says, be still. And again, that's because be still and be silent are the same things. Let me teach. Hot second. I got to hurry, though. Whenever you're reading the Bible, you need to understand Hebrew and Greek words have a semantic range. Okay? That semantic range means that there's multiple English words that can be used for one Hebrew or Greek word. This is why I'm always telling people who gets messed up. When you're studying the Bible, the first thing that you need to understand, the first mistake everybody makes when they start doing word studies, because word studies are amazing. They make you feel smart. Feel like, oh, I learned a little something. But the first mistake everybody makes is they forget that definitions don't define words. Context does. Whenever you're studying word studies, definitions don't define words. Context does. What do I mean by that? If I say my dog is sick, the context of the conversation will tell you what I mean by my dog. If you just take the regular definition in Webster of dog, well, you may misunderstand the entire conversation. You may think my dog's at a kennel when he's actually at the dang on ER. You go to the wrong place, right? Right? Definitions don't define words. Context does, because the word, the semantic range of the Hebrew and Greek word, right? So that's semantic range. There's another word study thing called the semantic domain. The difference between range and domain whenever you want to study the Bible. Quick tip, real quick, just a side note. If ever you want to study the Bible, the semantic range tells us the range of meanings. So when you're looking up a word, one translation may say be still, the other translation may be silent, but the Hebrew or Greek word is the exact same word. Well, they just chose that word. That's actually an interpreter's understanding of a word. But semantic domain is, I'm actually going to now look at the range of words, and try to figure out why the author actually used that specific word. Because sometimes I can understand what an author is saying by understanding what he didn't say. Because he could have used that word, but he used that word, which tells me what he's actually trying to convey. So, if you're reading your Bible, if I say be still, if I say be silent, I'm saying the exact same thing. All right? Now, back to the regular schedule program. God tells us to be still and silent to keep us from making the wrong moves. God tells us to be still and be silent to keep us from making the wrong moves. Notice, Israel is leaving Egypt, leaving oppression and abuse of over 400 years and Pharaoh, because God has told him to pursue him. That's a whole other message, right? God causes Pharaoh to pursue the Israelites so that they can see his power. So sometimes God allows things to happen in your life, and if you learn to be still in those things, you'll actually see the power of God. But that's another thing. He wanted them to experience his power, not just hear of it. But that's another message. Now, as Pharaoh was coming to Israel, they get afraid, and they cry out to God. But they don't just cry out. They express that they actually should have just stayed in Egypt. Now that's their logic. And most of us are led by our own logic and understanding. And maybe if Moses wasn't there, they would have just surrendered to the Egyptians and stopped fighting for their freedom. Maybe if Moses wasn't there, they would have surrendered to the Egyptians and stopped fighting for their freedom. Okay, you missed it. How many people see their situation as hopeless and impossible instead of fighting for freedom, fighting for change? You surrender to it saying, hey, this is just what it is. I'm used goods. Nobody wants me in my baggage, so let me just stay in my toxic relationship, because at least I got somebody, and somebody is better than nobody. Be still. All right, I'm tired. I've been fighting for this addiction for 5 years. I can't be free. I'll never be free. And now, since you allowed that thought into your head, now you go and you take that drink, you sniff that line, you hit that cigarette, you watch that show, you call that person. Be still. See, when God tells us first to be silent, he's telling it to us because our fear and hopelessness always causes us to make decisions that are not healthy for us and where God is not at. Job 13:5 says this about silence. He said, oh, that you would have kept silent, it would be your wisdom. Oh, if you would keep silent, it would be your wisdom. And notice why it would be wisdom for the Israelites to be still and be silent. Moses says, fear not and stand still. He says this because they would have turned around and see the salvation of the Lord. Why is it wise to learn to be still and be silent? Because in being still and in being silent, God is working. See, it would be wise to be silent because in our silence, God's work. Notice that God is going to be fighting for them. But his fighting for them, according to Moses, is dependent on Israel being still. He tells them the Lord will fight for them if they only be still. If you don't be still, he's not fighting. Right? You take God's opportunity away to work when you don't learn to just be silent in his presence. Trusting, right? Because that's essentially what we're talking about. Be still, be silent essentially means trusting God. What he's essentially telling us in those moments of crying out in anxiety, crying out in frustration, crying out in pain, crying out of the unknown, essentially what he's telling us is trust me and let me work. But see how the enemy twists that? The devil has convinced us that God is absent in silence, when the Bible teaches us that in silence, God is working. And I get it. Silence is hard. Silence is hard. When Coretta told us a minute ago to be still for 2-3 minutes, you didn't. It's hard. Matter of fact, we didn't. We started singing again because it is hard to just sit still. Right? But learning to be silent is actually healthy. So what that tells me is that being silent is about trusting in God for salvation, trusting in God who will fight. What that tells me is that when God says be still, he's calling for us to stop focusing on our own strength in the face of chaos. Israel was afraid of the Egyptians and their army. And they said they would die, meaning they didn't think they can actually win the fight. They were afraid and hopeless because they felt they weren't strong enough to win the fight. And let's be real, on their own, they weren't. Let's be real, on our own, we not. My anxiety over the salvation of my children, my wife's anxiety that she talked about 2 weeks ago over the salvation of her sisters comes from us thinking we can win this fight. But this fight is too big for us. If we could actually save people, Jesus would not have had to come and die. Our stress, our exhaustion, our hopelessness comes because we have done all that we could do to no avail. And so we determine that we can't achieve it. And I'm sure you can relate. But God says, stop focusing on your own strength in the face of trials and chaos. Our own strength will exhaust us. Our own strength will discourage us and kick our butts. But when we surrender our situations to God, all his power, and we trust in his timing and his plans, it doesn't mean that our situation is going to be fixed. But it does mean that we can trust in God, who will then remove the burden and heaviness that our situation cripples us with. Right? For it was Jesus who said, come to me, all you who are heavy, who are burdened and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Be still. And be still is a call to rest in God's power and authority. Now, understanding is different, so let me be clear. When I say be still, it does not mean inactivity. Being still does not mean inactivity. How do I know that? Because right after he told them, be still, verse 15 says, the Lord said to Moses, why are you crying to me? Tell the people of Israel to go forward. Go forward. He just told them, be still. And then he says in the next verse, why are you still talking? Tell them to go forward. You're crying out to me. You're crying out to me in anxiety. You're crying out to me in frustration. And God is like, listen, be still and go forward. You don't have to continue to cry out to me, because if you just be still and go forward, you will see those things that you are crying out for me, those fears, those battles, those anxieties, you will see them begin to shift. Then you will see the salvation of the Lord. In other words, continue to do what God has said to do, regardless of how it looks or how discouraged you may be. If you say you're being still and you aren't doing anything, you're not being still biblically, you're actually moving. What do I mean by that? Because being still is trusting in God. But if I don't learn to be still, that means I'm trusting in my own ability, which means I'm moving according to my understanding. And when I start to move according to my understanding, if I just look at Exodus 14, I'm going to be afraid. I'm going to want to move the wrong way. I'm going to want to make the wrong move, right? And so, press forward this year. And for me, that means keep talking to Jesus about my family. Keep pressing towards what God has said and what God has told us to do. It may be discouraging at times, and the sea may be closed in front of us. But instead of fear, keep walking and witness the power of God. Trusting in God is moving forward despite how you feel or what you see or how your logic tells you or what your logic tells you. What God said to do, do it. That's ambition, life goals, ethics, and morality. Be still, be silent, that you may see the salvation of the Lord. And it doesn't mean do nothing and see what God will do. It means move forward, trust in what God said to do, so that you will see the salvation of God. And we know how this story goes. They go forward. God gives them the next instructions, part the sea. They walk through it. The Egyptians try to follow them. God closes the sea. All the Egyptians die. The Israelites are delivered. But it was because they pressed forward that they were able to see the power of God. If we don't learn to press forward, we'll never be able to see God work. If we be still worldly instead of being still biblically, we will never see God work. Experiential knowledge will grow as we take those leaps of faith. See, first God tells us to be silent so that we don't lean on our understanding and move wrong. Then he tells us to be silent to press forward. The difference is that in the noise of life, we move according to our understanding, but in the silence, we move according to God's instruction. Here's the question. Are you being led by the noise or the silence? What's leading you? The chaos of life and your anxiety to try to fix it? Or the stillness of being in God's presence and moving according to his instructions? For many of us, it's the noise. But here's the problem with moving according to the noise. The noise will always get louder, right? And so we must learn to be silent and trust in God and not lean on our understanding. And that is what being still means. The International Standard Bible Encyclopedia says this, as I hurry: trust in Yahweh's providential rule lies behind several texts that exhort God's people to be still. By refraining from efforts to save themselves, God's people demonstrate their faith that Yahweh alone is the source of their salvation. And this is what God is telling me. He hasn't abandoned me. He hasn't abandoned you. He's calling us to do the opposite of what Satan is leading us to do. Satan's trying to convince us that God's response means we can't trust him and that he's forsaken us. God's response is calling us to place trust in him and experience his presence and power. And so the most beautiful thing that we can learn to do in 2021 is to be still, be silent, and wait. For in silence, God is working. So we're going to be looking at these different passages where God is calling for people to be still and silent, or commanding things to be still and be silent. And what we will learn is that truly in all things and in all areas of our life, if we learn to be still, if we learn to be silent, we may begin to see experience God. And we may begin to know God beyond the cognitive reading of his power if we only learn to be still, be silent, and wait. Everybody's moving. Everybody's going somewhere. With everything they're trying, just to make it. I am not there. But when the noise is just a moment, you're going to hear the gospel. And we're going to ask you if you believe that, if you want to receive that, to just simply text Christ to the number below. But I want you to take that time seriously. And maybe you've been away from God. Maybe you allowed the cares of life and the words of the enemy to cause you to stop believing in God and to stop forsaking God. And maybe you're listening and now you're like, wait a minute, I need to come back to the Lord. We want to give you that opportunity to do that as well by texting Christ to the number below. Amen. And maybe you're just somebody who's like, nah, I still believe in God, but I don't trust him like that. I've dealt with some things in 2021. I've lost some things in 2021. I've seen God work in other people's lives, but not in my life. And so I don't trust him like that no more. Man, I want to talk to you. I want to help you. I want to walk with you. I want to pray with you. And so if that's you, you too, text Christ to the number below, and we're going to reach out to you. Thank you. I love you. I'm looking forward to this series. Come back. Continue to visit us. You don't want to miss one, because we're going to go through all of the different situations that will resonate with you, and how God said be still and how we can trust in him in those situations. So share it with a friend, tag a friend, and tell them that you heard a message that's going to change your life, and invite them to join us next week. I love you. Take care. See you soon.
So 2020 was a crazy year, right? We can all agree. Life was turned upside down. Stressors beyond stressors, things that we never imagined would happen started happening. We look forward to 2021 coming in, and wow, 2021 didn't seem like it was going to start off much better. What if we didn't look to the world for the peace and the comfort and the stillness in our lives? What if there was something else out there that no matter what 2020 brings and 2021 and 2022, what if there was something that could bring you everything that you hoped to achieve and felt so helpless as we went through this last year? I'm here to tell you that there is. There's a God, the God who created us, who loves us immensely beyond anything we ever could think, ask, or imagine. A God who would do anything so that you could enter into a relationship with him, and that anything that he did was send his son to die on a cross for our sins. John 3:16 says that God so loved the world that he sent his only son to die for us, that whoever should believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. We often hear that called the gospel, but it just simply means that we recognize that in ourselves, we are not capable of the calmness, of the peace, of the stillness that we seek and desire. That in ourselves, it's not possible. We recognize that we are missing the mark when it comes to doing the things that we want to do to be right, to be good, to be righteous. And that there is a way that we can have that. It says that the wages of sin are death. And that we died, but Jesus did that death for us, right? Jesus went to the cross and he died for us. He lived a perfect life here on earth for 33 years. He willingly went to the cross and gave up his life. He raised from the dead, and it says now that he is sitting with the Father. All you have to do in order to accept all the peace that God wants to give you through a son, all the calmness, all the comfort, is to repent. It simply means that you are going to turn from doing things your way. You're going to turn from trying to figure things out on your own. You're going to turn from doing things that give you pleasure temporarily. And you're going to move towards the things that God says are going to give you that peace, the things that God says are going to bring you joy. You're going to turn from that, and then you're going to trust and believe that the Lord Jesus Christ is the one who is going to be able to give you that comfort, that is going to be able to bring you that peace, that is going to be able to give you joy in the midst of a year like 2020, in the midst of how 2021 started off. The Bible says that if you confess that you are a sinner, and that if you believe in your heart that Jesus is who he says he is, that is all it takes in order to receive the free gift of salvation. We here at Reach City Church are praying that you have heard that message of the gospel and that you are ready to come to the end of yourself and grab on to Jesus and believe that he is going to do everything that I've said that he will do and even more. If you believe that, if you've trusted in that message, we ask that you text Christ to the number you see below and that you